Добрый день, TechTrain. It's nice to be here. I'm streaming to you live from London, and as everybody knows, London is the capital of Great Britain. And I'm going to talk to you today about the web that never was. Now, Douglas Adams, the British author, he wrote The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and he had this wonderful quote about how to make sense of the world. He said, anything that is in the world when you're born is normal and ordinary and just a natural part of the way the world works. Anything invented between when you're 15 and 35 is new and exciting and revolutionary, and you can probably get a career in it. Anything invented after you're 35 is against the natural order of things. So this is me, Dylan Beattie. At the moment, I'm, among other things, I'm running my own online software training company, Ursatile. So check us out, doing all kinds of fun things with remote training sessions. I'm an MVP. I run the .NET user group here in London. As Max said, I invented a programming language called Rockstar so that everybody can become a Rockstar developer. Now, I was born in 1978. I was born into a world where computer networks already existed, where home computers were just starting to become a thing, the Apple II and the BBC Micro and these kinds of computers. I grew up, you know, in the 1980s where we had telephones and dial-up and email and all these kinds of things. The World Wide Web was invented around my 14th birthday. And I did go and get a good job in it, working on the web. I became a webmaster and then a programmer, and now I do all these interesting things with software. So I made a very good career out of that. Things that were invented after I turned 35, and therefore are against the order of nature, smartwatches, fidget spinners, and Kubernetes. These things are all wrong, and I don't understand them, and I don't know why we need them. But you know, the point that Douglas Adams is making with that quote is that human beings, we are very, very quick to kind of, the things which are comfortable to us, we just assume that that's obviously the right answer. We take those things for granted. We think that's the way the world works. He had this other lovely quote. He said, technology is stuff that doesn't work yet. We don't talk about chairs as being technology because they work. You sit on a chair and it holds you up. It's fine. We talk about things like video conferencing as being technology because still all of us, every week there's a point where we can't hear somebody or it uses the wrong microphone. And so that's technology for us. And, you know, it is kind of easy to think that all of this technology that exists in the world around us, you know, it started out with these prototypes and they got refined and we had gramophones and then Walkman and then MP3 players and cars have evolved and computers have evolved. And, you know, it is quite easy to think that the systems and technology we have now survived because it was the best. This kind of idea, Charles Darwin, the survival of the fittest. And, you know, we forget that that's not really how history works. The stuff that we've got, the phones we use, the network protocols, the computers, they often weren't the best solution. They were just the ones that got lucky. The one that happened to be there on the day when the venture capitalists were investing. The ones that happened to be the first to market. The ones that happened to be the most popular, you know. And for every innovation that succeeded, there are dozens, hundreds of technologies that just vanished into history. And what I want to do today is I want to think about what might have happened if we had picked some of those alternative solutions. So let's rewind. We're going to start at the beginning because in the beginning, there was the mainframe, the IBM mainframe computer. This is the 1970s, and IBM are dominating the world. You know, even today, you think about Apple and Amazon and Google and big tech. We have about four or five big companies who dominate technology between them. But in the 1970s, IBM was all these companies put together. It was the absolute, you know, the monolith. It controlled the entire tech industry. And Thomas J. Watson, the head of IBM at the time, thought that one day the world might need as many as five computers, one computer on each continent. Now, around the same time that IBM is selling mainframes and consolidating their grip on reality, these two guys come up with an idea. It's a controversial idea. They're thinking, what if we sold a computer that was small enough that you could go and put it in your house? And they come up with the original Apple computer. It's a kit. You have to solder it together yourself, but it's cheap enough that people can afford it and they can have one of these in their own home. This starts a revolution. This starts Apple Computer, who go on to become one of the most successful companies in the world. Microsoft get wind of this. They hear that Apple are selling computers people can take home. They get frightened. And they send a couple of people out. They say, right, quickly, you need to go and build us a personal computer. You need to build a computer that is small enough that people can have it in their own home. Now, IBM in the 1970s could not innovate. It was too big. They could not do anything in a scale of months. And so they took a very bold decision. They said with the PC, we're not going to invent all the parts. We're just going to buy stuff we can find. We're going to buy chips from Intel. We're going to buy off-the-shelf serial buses and floppy disk drivers and all these different bits of technology. We don't need to invent them here. We can just get stuff out of China, Taiwan, Far East, wherever we can find it. We'll bolt it all together and we'll buy an operating system to run on it. And they went to see the best operating system vendors in the business, and we're going to find out in a minute who that was. Now, alongside all of this that's going on, the internet is being developed. The internet goes back to 1964 in a project called ARPANET, the Advanced Research Projects Agency Network. Now, around about 1970, 1980, you could draw, this is 1973, this is a hand-drawn map of the entire internet from 1973. Now, I think the kind of the birth of the modern internet, kind of a web and an internet that would look familiar to all of us now, probably dates to the early 1980s. IPv4, the protocol that most of us still use to connect online, was published in 1981. In 1983, January the 1st, that was the day that TCP/IP was chosen as the default protocol for connecting all of the computers all over the world. Now, when you connect together all the computers in the world, you suddenly find you have a new problem. Now, there are only really two hard problems in computer science: cache invalidation and naming things. So I want to talk to you now about DNS. Now, prior to the invention of DNS, if you wanted to put a new computer on the internet and other people be able to find it, you plugged it in and you picked up the phone and you called this lady, Elizabeth Finlow, who everyone known as Jake. And you'd say, hey, Jake, we have a new computer. Could you put it on the network, please? Or could you put it on the hosts file? And the hosts file was actually a file. It was a text file that they maintained. And Elizabeth and her team at Stanford, they maintained this file. And that was basically the directory of the internet. And they would send copies of it via FTP and Gopher. And maybe if one of your team was going to Stanford, they'd bring back a tape with the latest hosts file on it. If you wanted to add a computer to the internet at the weekend, you couldn't. The office was closed. There was nobody to answer the phone. If you wanted to add a computer on Christmas or Thanksgiving or Easter, you couldn't do it. The office was closed. There was no way of doing this. Now, as the internet grew and more people started adding more and more systems, it became obvious this was not going to scale. It wasn't realistic to expect everybody to manually update the host file all the time. We needed a better system, and that's where we meet this guy, Paul Mukhopetras. There were about five different systems in play, five ideas for a better way of assigning names and numbers and internet addresses on the net. They gave them all to Paul and said, Paul, can you go through these and pick out the best bits of all of them? And Paul did what I think most of us would have done if you asked us to review five different specifications. He threw them out and he came up with a completely new one. He invented DNS, the domain naming system. Now, DNS is a brilliant engineering solution. It's a hierarchical database that grows with the size of the network that it's managing. You have a small network, you run small DNS. You have a big network, you need big DNS, but that's all right, because big networks have lots of big DNS servers available to manage all this stuff. You know, DNS and the naming system that still works to this day has proved to be an incredibly brilliant, scalable solution to this thing. How we find and route to hosts and servers and services that exist out there on the internet. Now, around about this time, We meet this guy, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, who still to this day goes by the job title of web developer. Now, it's 1990. The Berlin Wall is coming down. The Cold War is starting to thaw. TCP/IP exists. SMTP exists. People can send email. DNS exists. Scientists and mathematicians and physicists all over the world are starting to use computer networks to communicate and to share their own work. Most computers are running DOS, installing Windows from floppy disks. Steve Jobs has been fired from Apple. And at CERN in France, this guy is working on information management systems. And he sends a proposal to his supervisor, information management, and it comes back with this comment at the top: vague, but exciting. Tim Berners-Lee starts to develop his ideas about something called hypertext, a way of publishing information online and allowing people to navigate from one document to another, from one resource to another. Now, you know, in retrospect, we take the web for granted. Obviously, that's how it was going to work because that's what we've got. Now, when I was an undergraduate studying computer science at Southampton University, there was a team there who were working on a completely different kind of hypermedia in the 1990s. This was a system called Microcosm. And Microcosm, instead of embedding links inside documents, Microcosm meant you would run a separate database of contexts and resources. And so when you opened a document or an image or a piece of text, it would crawl that document and it would find the phrases that you wanted to hyperlink to other resources, and it would build you this separate clickable window of all the navigation links available in that document. One of my professors was actually presenting alongside Tim Berners-Lee in 1992, and he got up and he presented the prototypes for Microcosm, and everyone went, oh, very good. And then Tim Berners-Lee got up and presented the first drafts of HTML and HTTP. I think that our guy from Southampton was a little bit bitter that Tim's ideas caught on and his didn't. And Microcosm survives to this day. It's now a private company down in Hampshire in the UK, and they use that technology to do things like document discovery on big legal cases like Enron. They have this, you know, crawl, find all the references to a particular lawsuit or a particular email or something and hyperlink all of those. But it's interesting to think there was a day when it could have gone either way, when this could have been what the real future of the World Wide Web looked like. But now we're going to get a little bit weird because we're going to mix things up. So, it's the 1990s. Tim Berners-Lee is in his office at CERN, and he's working on something called the World Wide Web. And one day, the computer network isn't available, and he picks up the phone, and he calls one of his colleagues, and he says, hey, I've got this WWW, and he stops, and he thinks, WWW. That's not a great acronym. That doesn't sound terribly easy. So he goes back to his desk and he just starts playing around with some ideas. He's like, well, maybe World Wide Web isn't the best name for this thing. Maybe we could call it the International Information Interchange. No. Maybe we could call it the Multinational Metadata Matrix. No. Eventually he thinks, I know. We'll call it the Global Repository of Interlinked Documents. We'll call it the Grid. That's a good name. Let's start thinking about it. Now, to transfer documents, to transfer anything over computer networks, we need to use a protocol. All protocols are already called something TP, FTP, SMTP, NTP. Tim thinks, well, it's the Hypertext Transfer Protocol, HTTP. And he's thinking, what do we need to be able to do? We need a way of saying, I would like you to get me that document. He's been doing a bit of work with relational databases. He thinks, all right, select is one of our protocol verbs here. You want to retrieve a document from a server, you can select it. If you want to create, publish, put a new document up there, create. It's a publishing protocol, after all. He wants anybody to be able to create and publish their own resources on the grid. Update, you need to make a change to something. Delete means you want to remove it. He looks at this and he thinks, you know, maybe we can do more than just documents. There might be a way we can actually use this to build interactive systems. Let's add another method here called submit. Now, the lovely thing about this piece of protocol design is these are all the same length. So when you look at your log files, everything lines up really nicely in neat vertical columns. Now, the next thing that he has to solve is, if you have something published on the grid, how do you find it? How do you tell people where it is? He plays around with some ideas and he comes up with the standard unique resource finder. I think surf might be a good idea. People might even talk about surfing the grid if this thing catches on. Now, the original prototype for one of these unique resource finders looks like this. http://user:/@grid.domain.com:/path??query:#fragment. Now, the first thing that anybody says is, why are you putting username and password in plain text on the screen? That's a bad idea. All right, scrub that. We'll handle that separately. Take that out. This query and fragment part on the end, that's probably optional, so we don't need that most of the time. http://grid.domain.com/path. Path doesn't matter. We can create routes. We can create entry points and what would become home nodes, and so we take that part of it out. And then he realizes that that // there, it makes sense if you're talking about a hard drive on like a Linux system or a file system, but it doesn't actually matter. It's not necessary. Take it out. http://grid.domain.com. That's when he has a good idea. What if we name the protocol the same as the host that is serving it? We have a convention we're going to introduce that says, if you've got a grid server on your network, give it the host name grid and use the grid protocol to access it. And then we can get rid of this ambiguous resolution. We don't need, is that a port number or is that a host name? Let's just use bang. So http://bang/grid.domain.com. And then we flip it around. The host name and the protocol are the same thing. Grid:bang:domain.com. Boom, nailed it. That is the standard unique resource finder. And one of Tim's colleagues says to him, Tim, don't you think grid:bang:cern.org sounds a bit silly? And Tim's like, hey, not as silly as http://www.cern.org. And it's like, yeah, wow, you're right. It's a good thing we fixed that one. Hey. Now, to be able to publish hypermedia, we need some kind of authoring format. We need a language, a markup language. And there was an early prototype that looked like this, with all these angle brackets everywhere. Now, CERN was a physics and mathematics research center. The scientists working there did equations, lots of equations in the work they were publishing. And one of them pops up and says, Tim, these angle brackets, we use those in our work. That's less than and greater than. Can you come up with another way? And so Tim goes and he thinks, yeah, angle brackets might break stuff. He looks at an ASCII frequency table and he finds the least common character. It does a big corpus analysis of all the things on the FTP server, discovers that this tilde character, this little squiggle, that's the rarest character. That's the least frequent. And so he thinks, all right, we'll use that as the key for our parser. The first rule, white space is ignored unless it's two consecutive new lines. If there's two new lines in a row, that means a paragraph break. This means a lot of text documents become grid documents without changing anything at all. If you want to start marking up your documents, use this syntax. Tilde H1, that's a heading level one. Bold text, B. Let's have a look at a slightly more developed example of this. Now, here we can see a page which has some attributes, some metadata. So it's HTML, the hypertext markup language. And the language of this document is English, lang en. We've got some metadata. This isn't for people, this is for machines. The title is, it's HTML, Jim, but not as we know it. And then we have a document section. It has a heading one, it has a paragraph, it has a link, which has this surf syntax embedded in it, grid:bang:cern.ch/hello.html. You can link to other documents in your paragraphs. You can even embed images in the markup stream. Tim publishes this specification, puts it online, a request for comments, the HTML and the hypertext transfer protocol, HTTP, and the world loves it, and it goes crazy, and people all over the world start reading and writing and publishing and creating grid servers and writing their own HTML. It isn't long before we get the first graphical grid client. It is this thing. NCSA Mosaic came out of the National Computer for Supercomputing Applications in Illinois. It supports all the important network protocols, the Network News Protocol, FTP, Gopher, but it also supports HTTP and this new grid authoring language. People smell opportunity. People smell money. They start selling books. Grid Programming for Dummies becomes a bestseller. O'Reilly come out with Grid Programming in a Nutshell. People go and buy loads of these books. Grid fever is sweeping the world. Now, while this is going on, you recall back in the 1980s when IBM built their PC, they went to the best operating system vendors in the business to get the operating system for their new personal computer. That was this guy, Gary Kildall, the head of a company called Digital Research. Digital Research had an 86 operating system for the Intel 86 processor called CPM, the Control Program for Microcomputers. IBM went and struck a deal with Gary Kildall, and this is where Gary pulled a little bit of a bait and switch that would change the course of history. He licensed his CPM operating system to IBM at very reasonable rates, on condition that he could also sell it, because he had seen something that IBM hadn't. He knew that the future of home computing was not anything to do with the hardware. The IBM PC, anybody could build a PC if they could get the right bits from the right factories in China and Taiwan. The thing which was going to control the market was going to be the operating system that ran the software. By the time IBM realized their mistake, it was too late. In 1984, Digital Research came out with MPM86, the multitasking program for microcomputers. It's a truly multitasking operating system. It uses all the power of the 286 processor. There's no more worrying about a 640K memory limit. And it runs on any hardware. Dell, Wang, Osborne, all these people are selling PC-compatible computers that run Digital Research's operating system. Whilst this is going on, Steve Jobs is not happy. Now, the Apple computer that they built out of Cupertino, California, out of their parents' garage, that did really well. But in 1987, this guy, Steve Jobs, the visionary CEO of Apple, is ousted. There is a hostile takeover. They buy out all of his stock and they basically kick him out of the company that he founded. So he moves across the street. He hires a couple of engineers and he creates this. This is the next workstation. Now, nobody's ever seen a computer quite like this before. Computers are beige, right? This is black. Computers are boring. This is a cube. Computers have big clunky switches. The next, you switch it on by just tapping both the shift keys at the same time. It comes with this massive 19-inch high-definition color display. You know, it is, most people have never seen anything like it. It is expensive. This computer costs tens of thousands of dollars. But for doing high-end software, workstation, medical research, these machines are absolutely unsurpassed. Now, in the late 1980s, much to the consternation of the United States Department of Justice, Digital Research, who are the largest operating system vendor on the planet, they merge with the WordPerfect Corporation, who are the biggest word processing and office software company on the planet, and they create the largest, richest software company in history. It's a company called Perfect Digital. We'll hear more about them in a second. Now, this is around the time that these two gentlemen cross paths. The guy in glasses here is Jim Clark. Jim founded the company called Silicon Graphics. He's one of the pioneers of high-powered graphics workstations and 3D. The guy on the right, that is Marc Andreessen. Now, Marc Andreessen had worked at NCSA. He had built Mosaic, the first grid browser. He's one of the best network programmers that we'd ever seen up until that point. And he's a bit bored with Mosaic. Jim Clark has just left Silicon Graphics, and they're wondering what to work on next. And, you know, they got a couple of ideas. Marc says to him, why don't we build another grid browser? We can call it like a, you know, the Mosaic Killer or something, or Mozilla, or maybe that could be an interesting project. And as they're bouncing this idea around, they get a phone call. It's Nintendo. Nintendo of America. They want to build a 64-bit games console. They want to get this thing out into the market, and they want Marc Andreessen and Jim Clark to help them build a network for it. They think that the grid will allow people to play games against each other over telephone lines and over cable TV connections. They're really looking at the long future here. They want to hire the best possible people to make this happen. This sounds like a lot of fun. Marc Andreessen, Jim Clark, okay, they make the deal, they move up to Seattle, they go into Netscape America headquarters, and at some point in their first week, they meet these two gentlemen, the two Johns, John Romero and John Carmack. Now, these guys had spent a couple of years building games together, and they knew more about pushing the limits of the PC platform and the CPM operating system than pretty much anyone else. A few years earlier, they had created Super Mario 3, and they had ported that to the PC architecture from the Nintendo console. Nintendo was so impressed, they rang them up and they said, John, we love it. Come and work for us. We'll let you build work on anything you like. When they arrive there, they discover that Perfect Digital are working on their Gem visual operating system. Andreessen and Clark have gone off to Nintendo at this point. The Mosaic killer grid browser is dead in the water. Perfect Digital are gearing up to do something big. Big, new, exciting visual operating system for the desktop. And they need a grid browser, because if you don't have a grid browser, you're not a serious contender. Now, they're looking around, you know, what can we do? Do we build something from scratch? Do we try and buy something? Do we acquire something? And it turns out that thanks to the WordPerfect Corporation going way back with the legal profession, lawyers and attorneys and solicitors in the US, they have some connections. And at Cornell University, there is a guy called Thomas Bruce. He runs the library. He's not even really a programmer. He's a librarian. But he has built a grid browser as part of his work at the library at Cornell Law School. It's called Cello. The WordPerfect Perfect Digital people set up a meeting. They agree to acquire the software and the IP for this. They fold that into the latest version of their suite of Office applications, and they release GridPerfect. Now, GridPerfect is the most sophisticated grid browser that any of us has ever seen. It supports all the protocols, it supports embedded images, but it adds something new, something that didn't exist in previous incarnations. It adds support for a new protocol called SAFE, the Secure Application Frame Encryption Protocol. Now, gridbangdomain.com has a problem. It's open text, it travels on the wire, anybody can intercept it. This means you can't use it for confidential communication, you can't use it for buying things, credit card numbers, banking. None of these kinds of things will work on the grid until this SAFE protocol is adopted. Suddenly, we have a secure way of communicating between clients and servers. The grid has become, it's not just a publishing medium anymore, it's an application development platform. Now, it's around about this point, we've got the Secure Application Frame Encryption Protocol. Someone decides we need a way of running code inside a grid browser. And they're looking for what programming language shall we embed? And there is only one choice. If you were going to embed a programming language inside a browser, that programming language would be Lisp. Lisp is over half a century old. It still has this perfect, timeless air about it. I wonder if the cycles will continue forever, a few coders from each new generation rediscovering the Lisp arts and handing down parentheses, elegant weapons for a more civilized age. Now, they want to embed Lisp in a grid browser. They need a really, really good Lisp programmer. So they make a couple of calls and they make a couple of emails and they talk to this guy, Paul Graham. Paul is the founder of ViaWeb. Along with his partners, Robert Morris and Trevor Blackwell, Paul has been pioneering the art of building server-side grid applications in common Lisp. He's one of the first people who really saw the potential of the grid as an application development platform, not just a big database of documents. So when Perfect Digital come knocking and offer to buy his Via Web startup, I mean his Via Grid startup, for $5 million in cash and $5 million in stock, Graham and his colleagues jump at that opportunity. Now, waiting in the wings at this point is another titan in the world of modern North American computing, Sun Microsystems. And Sun have invented this language called Java, which is object-oriented, and it runs on GEM desktops, and it runs on their own Solaris and Sun OS systems. And they're really trying to push Java onto the grid in a big way. And they have a couple of meetings, and they suggest to the team at Perfect Digital, you know, what if we could, embed Java as the language in your new thing, and maybe like a cut down version that we could call Java Lisp or LavaScript or Hyper Java or something. Paul Graham comes in and he hosts a meeting, and over the course of 3 or 4 hours, he changes the history of application development forever. He talks about Lisp, he talks about closures, he talks about lambdas, he talks about something called S expressions. He explains the way that the Lisp language exposes macro types, which give it the ability to write and rewrite its own program code in a way that most programming languages can't even imagine. By the end of the day, the deal is done. The decision has been made. There will be no Java in the grid browser. They are going to embed Lisp, Hyper Lisp, in Grid Perfect, the next release. And that's going to be the development platform that drives the grid as a distributed application development environment. You want to have a look at some Hyper Lisp and see what it looks like? So here we go. Nice and easy. This is Hello World in Hyper Lisp. We have our HTML document here, and we have a code block with a type, text/Hyper Lisp. Now, what we're going to do here is we're going to use Lisp's S expression syntax, and we are going to bind an event. The event is called submit. The document submit, when that happens, bind that to this lambda function. The lambda takes an element and an event, and it alerts Hello World. Click Hello World. Let's have a look at a slightly more sophisticated example. Now, there's a couple of things about Hyper Lisp which make it a really, really powerful language for building grid applications. First of all, the element IDs in your document markup, they map directly onto symbol types. You don't need to get elements by ID or anything. They're just there. You could target them natively. The postfix notation means that we can use hyphens inside our variable names, which no other programming language really allows you to do at that point. This tallies nicely with some of the conventions that are starting to emerge from people who are authoring grid documents. Lambda callbacks mean you can do asynchronous client-server communication easily. This idea of delegating execution to a function that will then return, that's pretty much baked into the language syntax from day one. So in this example here, the main form submit, we're going to bind that event to a lambda that will take the element and the event. Now, you've got to read this stuff kind of from right to left, because over there we've got get value element right at the end. We're going to work out what did the user type into the form here. And then we are going to take that and we are going to send it to the grid using submit as our method to this greeting resource, which is identified by a resource finder, by a serf. We're going to get a response back from that, and we're going to set the value of the greeting span. So this is a form that asks the user what's their name. They click the button and then we say hello. We drop their name in there. Now, at this point, the Lisp programmers are coming out of retirement and they're delighted. They think this is fantastic. A new generation is learning all about macros and symbolic expressions and Lisp processing. And as all this is going on, excitement starts to build and Perfect Digital come out with GEM 95, the completely new version of their flagship operating system. It's got sneak previews all over the IT press. There's wall-to-wall coverage in magazines. August the 24th, 1995, GEM 95 is released. It takes over the world. They get the Beatles back together to perform Get Back at the launch party for this thing. The back button in the grid browser, that becomes the metaphor for a new kind of exploration. Play with the computer. It doesn't matter if you make a mistake. Just click back and get back to where you want it to be. The whole thing is a coup. It's brilliant. It takes over the world. And while this is going on, the Apple Corporation are sad because they are losing market share by droves. Nobody is using them anymore. The company hasn't done well since they kicked Steve Jobs out in the 1980s. They've got a very loyal following in print and desktop publishing. But the world is changing. Publishing is dying. Everything is going to be on the grid before very long. And Apple Computer do not know what to do about it. They've been doing a big rewrite of their core operating system, a project they called Copeland. But it's not going anywhere. It's not producing anything. And eventually, they sit down and they're like, look, what the hell are we going to do? And Gil Amelio, the CEO of Apple at the time, he says, well, I got a good idea. Why don't we see if we can get Steve Jobs to come back? And they nearly laugh him out of the room. Steve Jobs come back to Apple after everything they did to him. That is never going to happen, Gil. Come on. Think of a better idea. We've got to be able to come up with something better. And he thinks, well, there is another idea. There's a couple of engineers left Apple last year, and they got their own operating system project they're working on. It's a thing called BIOS, and it's kind of nice. It's modern. It's clean. It's got this microkernel with multiple media streams architecture built in. Let's go and take a look and see what they can do. Now, BIOS is a masterpiece of software engineering. By the end of 1996, the B Corporation have abandoned their plans to build their own hardware. They're not building B boxes anymore. They are porting their operating system in a quirk of fate to Apple hardware. The timing is perfect for the acquisition deal. The new generation of Apple computers, they love the styling of the old Apple devices. They love the performance, the media streams, dual processors. It's got a 10-second boot time. That's unheard of. Apple acquire BIOS for $100 million in cash and stock. And summer 1997, they bring out their new line of home computers. Now, it's Apple Computer, of course, but everybody immediately starts calling these things the banana boxes because they're bright yellow. And people want these in their houses. You walk into somebody's living room or you go around for dinner, they got the bright yellow box up in their living room. You think, wow, these people, that's a bright yellow computer. That's bold. That's beautiful. I want one of those. It starts and sparks this kind of crazy desire. Everybody wants to get one of these computers and figure it out. Now, one of the few things that BIOS did not bring to the table here was a grid browser. They didn't have one. There was no grid browser capability built into BIOS. And so Apple go shopping, and they end up talking to, of all people, Telenor, the Norwegian telephone company. Because it turns out that Telenor have a grid browser project they've been working on. It's working under the codename Opera with a Presto rendering engine. But Apple say, hey, we want that. We'll buy it. How much money do you want? They do a deal. This becomes incorporated into the new BIOS Apple operating system. It's called B-Link because BIOS, because B-Link, because bananas. But it's very, very quickly renamed to Blink. So Apple launched their new operating system, new bright yellow boxes. Blink is the grid browser that's running. Lots of people are getting involved in this. And the grid is taking off. Everyone is getting free grid space, free sites, free nodes, free documents. People are putting things up everywhere. Something called search engine optimization is starting to happen. And it's becoming almost impossible to navigate the grid. The good content is drowning. It is getting swamped and buried in the noise. And it's around about this time, two engineers working out of a garage in Stanford, because all these innovations for some reason come out of garages in California. I have no idea why this is. They have come up with a system. They've come up with an algorithm. It's called Backrub. And it's called Backrub because what it does is it looks at a document on the grid and it finds all the other documents that point to it. And it says, all right, well, if nobody's pointing to this document, then this thing probably is not important. If millions of other documents are pointing to this one is probably very important. By analyzing the backlinks into it, they have come up with a way of ranking pages on the grid, something they're going to call page rank. Now, they spin this up and they turn this into a company. They're looking for a name for the company. And one of their kids has been at school that day and he's learned about a number called a Google, which is a 10 followed by a million zeros or 1,000 zeros or 100 zeros. I can't remember which. And he says, hey, Dad, we learned about this number called a Google. And then Larry thinks, that'd be a good name for our company. So he sends Sergey an email. Hey, what about Google? Unfortunately, the spelling check kicks in as the email is getting sent. And the company ends up being registered as Google. Search the grid using Google. Now, Google works brilliantly. It is fantastic. It has the best search engine technology anyone's ever seen. Suddenly, you can find things on the grid again, just like back in the day when it was small and manageable. But they have a problem. They have no way of making money out of this thing. It works too well. This beautiful, sparse, minimalist interface they've got here, there's no space on there for advertising. There's nowhere to get people to put in a credit card number. They have no way of turning their amazing, brilliant idea into a product. What they don't want to do is sell advertising all over everything. An advertising-based revenue model for the grid is just going to turn this into some kind of horrible arms race of who can have the most obnoxious banners and the loudest videos and things playing. They do not know what to do about it. And as they are scratching around, they put the company up for sale. They are looking for someone to come along and buy Google. And they're not asking for much at this point. They're asking for a few hundred thousand dollars. It's around about this time that they get a phone call. Steve Jobs is on the line, and he wants to talk. We don't know what happened in that phone call, but we do know what happened next. It's 1999. It's April. The press is starting to buzz about something called the Millennium Bug, that at the end of the year, all these computers are going to flip over to 00 and crash the airplanes and launch the missiles, and we're all going to die horribly because of a computer error. And while the press is going crazy about that, computer journalists all over the world, they get this. They get a plain black envelope, arrives on their desk. They open it up, and inside there is a card. It just says, get ready for the next generation. And on the back, there is a time, and there is a place, and there is a date, May the 4th. They think it's a new Star Wars movie. Lucasfilm issue a denial. There's no way they're ever making any more Star Wars movies. The original trilogy is perfect. Why would anyone make more of those films? The rumor mill starts working overtime. What is going to happen on the 4th of May? But it's all just rumors and speculation at this point. Finally, 4th of May rolls around. Journalists file in to the auditorium, and Steve Jobs takes the stage. He's talking about publishing. He's talking about networks. He's talking about the social impact of digital technology. And just as everyone is wondering where Steve Jobs is going with this, he reaches down behind the podium and he pulls out one of these. And the journalists are like, what? Is that a laptop? It's black, it's shiny, it's made of machined aluminium. It is the next book, and nobody has ever seen anything quite like it. And then in a masterstroke, a few dozen plants, people throughout the audience, they reach under their own seats and they pull out the first prototype run of next books. They open them up, and those next books are playing live video with no cables. Nobody has ever seen anything like this. What is this magic? Is this voodoo? What is this wireless internet networking thing we've got going on? The next book is a masterpiece, a 333 megahertz processor, 64 megabytes of RAM. It has 5 gigabytes of solid state flash storage. 5 gigabytes. It is running the latest version of the Next Step operating system. It ships with wireless internet. In the box, you get your laptop and you get a thing called the Next Stender. This sits in your house. You plug it into the telephone line. It bathes your house in Wi-Fi signal so you can browse the grid from your sofa, from your bedroom, from your kitchen, anywhere you are. And it ships with a grid browser, Nexus. Nexus goes all the way back to the original NCSA Mosaic browser. The DNA of that very first grid platform is baked into this operating system. And the whole thing is powered by search. You can open your next book. You can type in anything. It searches your own files. It searches the grid. It searches your own history. It searches your email. Powered by Google's revolutionary backrub page rank technology. Integrated into the browser. Integrated into the operating system. The millennium comes and goes. When the dust settles on January the 1st and everyone recovers from their hangovers, the world of the grid looks like this. We have Apple's revolutionary new Nextbook running the Nexus browser with first-class Hyperlisp and Google page support baked into it. We have Apple, we have the banana boxes, we have these running Blink, the browser that came out of a Norwegian telephone company. We have GridPerfect running on Gem 95, which by this point is Gem 98 and Gem 2000, and soon Gem 7. And we have Sun Microsystems kicking around in the corner still, desperately trying to plug Java. And whispers start coming out that Nintendo are working on something interesting. Now, other than the very brief and very successful Super Mario Quake World that came out of the collaboration, it's been a little while since Nintendo came out with anything. But in early 2002, there's buzz starts to build. You know, word on the street is they're working on something big. It's been nearly a decade since Jim Clark and Marc Andreessen met John Romero and John Carmack, with Nintendo writing the paychecks. Everything's gone a bit quiet, and in December 2002, Nintendo unveiled a platform that is going to change the world. It is called Reality. It is the first fully immersive digital virtual reality experience. It's a massively multiplayer online world. The graphics programming has been done by two of the best graphics programmers in the business, John Carmack. John Romero has designed the environments where you collaborate, you meet, you talk to people out there on the other side of the world. The network programming is by Marc Andreessen, one of the best network programmers we've seen. The hardware is Jim Clark, drawing on his rich pedigree of stuff that has come out of Silicon Graphics. It is a virtual world. It is William Gibson's Matrix. It's Neal Stephenson's Metaverse, brought to life. And as we're looking at reality, we're thinking, this is pretty impressive. But, you know, imagine if none of this had ever happened. Imagine a world without Blink. Imagine a world without Hyperlisp. Imagine a world where HTML still used angle brackets. Imagine a world where IBM had gone shopping and they ended up with Microsoft instead of Digital Research. It's kind of hard to imagine, isn't it? Now, I know what you're asking. You're thinking, how much of that did you just make up? Well, everything in that talk was probably one or two meetings away from actually being reality. In the early 1980s, IBM did go shopping to buy an operating system for the PC. There are two versions of this story. One of them says that they went to see Gary Kildall, and he was out flying. It was a nice day. He was out in his plane. And so IBM went, okay, well, he's busy. Who's next on the list? They went to see this guy, Bill Gates. Of course, the rest became history. Microsoft were the ones who realized that the future of home computing wasn't about hardware, it was about operating systems. Microsoft were the ones who consolidated MS-DOS into Windows 3.1, into Windows 95, into Internet Explorer, and for many years had a stranglehold on network business computing because of their acquisitions around that. The design of the World Wide Web. Now, the idea, the whole idea for this talk came from this piece of video I saw. It's an interview with Tim Berners-Lee in 2009. That's what started me thinking about how different the web could be. Now, you know, HTML, this angle bracket syntax we use, that's based on something called SGML, the standard generalized markup language. But SGML wasn't the only markup language that existed when Tim Berners-Lee started creating HTML. LaTeX has been around since Tech and LaTeX since the 1970s. There were programmers all over the world who were familiar with this kind of syntax, LaTeX document markup, which uses backslashes and angle curly brackets and things. The rich text format already existed. Microsoft had products that used RTF before the web was invented. So it's not a foregone conclusion that HTML would end up looking like SGML with all these angle brackets. Any one of these could have evolved into what became the authoring language for the grid or for the web. Embedding Lisp in a browser, well, you know, this was not anything like as far-fetched as it seems. The Emacs text editor has used Lisp as its embedded programming language for decades. In the early 90s, I worked with an engineering company, Arup, and they had people on staff who were draftspeople. They designed buildings using a program called AutoCAD. And AutoCAD has AutoLisp built into it. It has a Lisp programming interpreter. Lisp was the kind of logical choice. If people wanted to embed a language in an application, Lisp was the one they tended to use. Paul Graham is a real person. ViaWeb was a real company. ViaWeb was one of the very, very first companies to build server-side interactive software on the World Wide Web in our timeline. And Paul Graham is still out there and still evangelizing Lisp and these ideas around functional programming and symbolic expressions. And a lot of those ideas about exposing symbol types and doing asynchronous callbacks, the Lisp syntax in those examples I showed you, that's a fictional programming language, but it's syntactically valid. It's real Lisp. You could build that if you wanted to. Just good luck finding any browser that runs it. You'll have to transpile to JavaScript just like the rest of us do. John Carmack and John Romero, they're the people who built Quake. They're the people who built Doom. They're the people who founded id Software. You know, they have had a revolutionary impact on networked games development. And in the 90s, they really did port Super Mario Bros. 3 to the IBM PC. And they sent the disc to Nintendo. And they said, hey, you know, what do you think? And Nintendo said, this is brilliant. If you ever release this, we will sue you so hard it will leave a crater. Nintendo did not want anyone playing Super Mario on the computer they had in the office. They wanted people buying consoles because that's where the revenue was at. You can't copy consoles. You can't run them on the computer at work. That was Nintendo's business model. And so the two Johns took their code from Super Mario 3 and they changed the sprites and they redesigned the levels. And they came out with this, which is one of the first PC games I ever played, Commander Keen, Goodbye Galaxy. The DNA that underpins this game and the graphics programming that became Doom and Wolfenstein 3D and Quake, that came out of them porting Super Mario to the IBM PC. Marc Andreessen and Jim Clark really did talk to Nintendo about going to build a gaming network for them in the 90s. They decided not to. Of course, what they did was they went and founded the company Netscape and came out with the Netscape browser. But a couple of phone calls either way, maybe if the state of the network and, you know, phone lines, broadband had been a little bit more advanced, they'd have gone and done that instead. Cello was a real browser, real web browser, really was written by Thomas Bruce, who really was the librarian at Cornell Law School. Cello's still out there. You can find the executable. It ran on Microsoft Windows. And it is, you know, entirely possible. WordPerfect had lots of clients in the legal division. It is entirely possible that if WordPerfect had needed to build a grid browser at some point, they'd have gone knocking and they'd have bought Cello from Thomas Bruce and they'd have figured that out. BIOS was a real operating system. And they really were trying to port it onto Apple hardware in 1996. Of course, what really happened is that Apple bought Next. Steve Jobs did come back. The first thing he came out with was the blue iMac that everyone wanted in their living rooms, because, hey, it's a blue computer. How cool is that? He created, or, you know, was instrumental in designing the iPod, the first really successful digital music player, the iPad, the iPhone, you know, the impact of Steve Jobs coming back on technology that we now all use every day is, it's almost impossible to overstate. It really happened. And Larry Page and Sergey Brin, they really did come up with background. They really did name it PageRank after Larry Page. They really did call the company Google, and it got a spelling mistake in it. It's just, in our world, it's Google L-E instead of Google G-O-L, after something that one of their kids had learned about in school that day. And they really were trying to sell it. In the early 1990s, Google tried to sell. Does anyone remember Excite? Excite, Google offered their algorithms for sale to the Excite search engine for less than $1 million. And Excite said, no, we don't think there's any value in this. We're not going to buy it, you know? And so we look at the technology that all of us have, all of us work on, and just, you know, remember, when you look at the things that succeeded, the things that got established, a lot of the time, it's not that they were the perfect solution. It's not that they were the right solution. It's that those were the solutions that just happened to be there, happened to hit the right thing with the right meeting, the right people, the right day. They got the critical mass. People started using them. They picked up. So next time, you know, you and your team are figuring out the best way to do something, remember that technology is not about survival of the fittest. It's about survival of the luckiest. And the way to get lucky is to tip the odds in your favor by just shipping lots of stuff as often and as early as you can. That's what these people did. It worked out for them. But as you can see from that talk, it could so easily have been very, very different. Спасибо, TechTrain. Thank you very much. Now, this is the point where when you do remote presentations, what you imagine is the applause of the audience. Because all I can see right now is me. I'm over there. I'm kind of waving and talking to myself on my own camera. And at any point now, Max, hey, Max, how you doing?
Yeah, it's weird on my end as well, because I was thinking if I'm on the broadcast talking there now, because I can see myself in the small screen and finally seeing there is another video here. So I have a question.
We're getting a little bit of interference on the signal, Max. Let's try it. We'll see if it cleans up a bit. But if we can't make it out, we might have to go and pick the questions up on the Zoom webinar in a minute. But let's try it. Go for it. What are the questions?
Yeah, so the question is, how did you get the idea of such talk? I mean...
The idea came, so like I said, the first thing that really started me thinking was that little video clip of Tim Berners-Lee saying, I could have done without the / in URLs. I'd always, Paul Graham, someone who I've been following for a long, long time, I used to read his blog, and he has this great book called Hackers and Painters about creating value and creativity and different kind of ways of thinking and ways of working. And he's always been a big evangelist of Lisp. And if you know Hacker News, the website, so Hacker News is one of Paul Graham's projects. He started that site. And Hacker News is actually built in a language called Arc, which is his own prototype next generation Lisp dialect. But you know, I learned Lisp at university. I learned Scheme, which is a very, very similar kind of functional language with a similar prefix notation and everything. And there's a lot of ideas in JavaScript that actually came from Scheme, because what Brendan Eich really wanted to do when they hired him at Netscape was he wanted to put Scheme in a browser, and it was pressure by Sun Microsystems that led to them coming up with the syntax that we recognize as JavaScript today with the curly braces, because they just, you know, people thought Scheme looked too alien. They thought it looked too unfamiliar. And I'm like, none of these people had ever seen a programming language before. You know, who are you trying to frighten? I don't think anyone realized, you know, how many people would go from never having written a program at all to being web programmers. I think everyone was like, oh, well, people are going to learn C and C++ at university. And then when they're programmers, maybe they'll go and write websites and web applications. And, you know, I do, there's a element of kind of, you know, poignancy in that talk, because I do wonder what the world would have been like if all the people who learned how to do website programming had been learning Lisp instead of JavaScript all these years, and, you know, what it might look like. But yeah, that was just, you know, a lot of funny little footnotes from history. The Super Mario thing, there's a book called Masters of Doom, which is about John Carmack and John Romero and the whole history of id Software, and that's where I found out the thing about the Super Mario port to the IBM MPC, and I thought, more people need to know about this. This is such a weird little note in history, you know. And that's kind of, you know, talks like that. Often it's just I have a whole bunch of nice ideas that I want to be able to tell people about because I think they're interesting. And I came up with, what if we make an alternate history and we plug all the bits and pieces in that way? I think Max has just disappeared. I think we may have lost him from the call.
Yeah, actually, he's just changing his mic. Something happened.
Okay.
You know, this is online. This is a broadcasting.
It is. Mic, I mean, so the two amazing things about doing events like this, you know, one of them is you think about how much technology has to work properly for this to be possible.
That's, you know, I'm totally talking, true, you know.
Yeah, you know, I'm in London right now. I'm talking to a Logitech webcam through USB, through a computer, through DSL, through this. You know, we're literally having a conversation now across London to Moscow is what, 3,000-4,000 miles something? Mm-hmm. And we're chatting away on video, and Max has just gone to fix his microphone. And it's amazing how that it works at all. And it's also never surprises me that every time there's just one little detail that worked last time, and it worked the time before, and it worked in the sound check, and then suddenly now it's like, oh, that didn't work so well. So But we're all getting better at it. We're all getting much, much better at it very, very quickly. So
yeah, hopefully, maybe in some near future, our broadcasting will be improved somehow. We'll get better equipment, better, you know, software to get these online conferences on the next level. So the next question. There is another next question. Dylan, do you think we are converging to an optimal web, or are these two paths really fundamentally different?
I mean, that's interesting, because I think convergence can be very dangerous. You know, you look at what's happening on the web at the moment. Microsoft Edge now has abandoned their Trident, the rendering engine. So Microsoft Edge now runs on WebKit, which is the same rendering engine that runs in Google Chrome, which is the same rendering engine that runs in Brave and a whole bunch of other browsers. And, you know, one of the big challenges is I've been working on the web since it was invented. I built my first web page in 1992. And, you know, I remember the days when there was Internet Explorer and there was Netscape, and they were completely almost incompatible. And anything clever with dynamic HTML or JavaScript, you basically had to write two different versions, and then neither of them would work on Safari because that was a different thing altogether. And, you know, we've reached an interesting point now where on the desktop, it doesn't matter if you're using Microsoft or you're using Google, you're still running the same engine, the same rendering engine. And that introduces some challenge. You know, what if the WebKit team decides that they're going to slow down any web page that has the word Firefox on it, because they want people to use theirs instead? And that, you know, it yields a degree of control to the people who control that code. And it's open source. You know, anybody who wants to can fork WebKit and take those changes out and use it to build their own browser. But in reality, that doesn't happen. Most people just use, they double click, they install, they use what they get. And then they become, you know, the whatever the browser vendors want to push on them. Firefox has done some amazing things with containers and isolated profiles and security and all these kinds of things. The Opera browser that I talk about there, you know, Opera was a real product, and it had its own. It had one of the best HTML rendering engines. I used Opera as my main browser for about 10 years, and I stopped when Google Chrome came along because it did the same stuff, only faster. You know, remember when Google Chrome was fast and minimalist and all the other browsers were bloated? And that's how software goes. You know, something comes out and it's like, we're fast and minimalist, and everyone goes, this is brilliant. And 5 years later, that's full of adverts and junk and extensions, and someone else goes, hey, look, new Firefox. And I installed Microsoft Edge, the new one, the other day. It's really, really good. But, you know, there is this convergence. It makes it easier to author platform content that works across multiple platforms. It makes it easier to learn because you have fewer different configurations to worry about. But then, you know, we have iOS, where every browser on iOS uses the same Safari WebKit rendering engine, because even if you run your own browser, you can't run your own renderer on iOS. Apple won't allow you to do it. We've got Google controlling, to some extent, the Android operating system, but obviously, again, that's open, so vendors can do different things with it. I think convergence is what happens naturally. I think, you know, convergence happens unless you have people pulling it in another direction. I think that the Mozilla Foundation and Firefox are very consciously trying to fight the convergence. You know, convergence is good for capitalism, and it's good for consumerism as well. It's good for the big companies because they want to converge and have everyone running their solution. And it's good for people who are building websites and building code because they don't have to worry about multiple formats. But you do then get to a point where it's like, oh, everyone in the world is now using the same browser, and that browser just did something that we don't like. So yeah, I do, certainly at the moment, I see massive convergence towards WebKit, and I see Firefox as the company who are like, we're actually trying to win here by doing better things around performance and privacy and isolating profiles and stuff. But you know, I've been working on the web for 25 years. I still have no idea what's going to happen next. I never have.
Okay, we have I'm not sure. Am I sounding like Darth Vader or not anymore?
No, not right now.
Oh, perfect.
You just switched.
You sound fine. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a disadvantage of having too many backup plans, because you have to reconnect sometimes, because my system thinks, oh, why you have so many microphones and devices? Because I have three backup plans right now. And well, okay, I'm not sure. While I was reconnecting, have you had a chance to answer the question about your favorite abandoned technology?
No, I haven't. My favorite favorite modern technology, yeah, did you say?
Yeah, let me read it. So what's your favorite abandoned technology that was really useful and you would like to succeed but never got the technology never got the popularity it deserved just because it was not lucky enough?
The thing that I think for the world generally was WordPerfect, because WordPerfect was an incredibly capable operator, word processor. My first job, I worked for a company in between 1996 and 1998 that were, when I started, they had WordPerfect everywhere. WordPerfect on Windows and WordPerfect on DOS. And you know, WordPerfect was a really, really powerful, it had a markup-based format. You could see the document, the hidden coding in it, and work out why things weren't lining up properly. It was really stable. I know we're talking, you know, hundreds of thousands of pages, big legal contracts and documents, and it worked really reliably on those. You know, Microsoft, certainly in the 1990s, was a very, very different, I think, was a very different company to the Microsoft that we know today in 2020. And in the 90s, Microsoft was at war. They were out to kill WordPerfect by any means necessary. And, you know, one of the things that I had to do when I was doing help desk was I installed Word. And people were like, why aren't we using WordPerfect? And I'd be like, because our customers have now made it a requirement of doing business that we have to give them all the specifications in Microsoft Word 97 format. And, you know, professional engineers who'd been building buildings for 20 years are like, but this isn't very good. Why can't we use the tools that worked well? And it's like, because contract, because business, because, you know, Microsoft are pushing this thing hard. You know, there was, in the late 90s, there was WordPerfect for Linux, and there was one point WordPerfect for Java. And, you know, I would love to have seen a world where Microsoft Windows became the dominant operating system, but WordPerfect and Quattro Pro had become the dominant word processor and spreadsheet, because I think that would have given us some healthy competition that would probably have accelerated the rate of innovation in that particular space. My own personal technology, the thing I miss the most, I don't know, probably those, you remember the music, like MP3 players you got in the 90s with the skins that were all weird, funky shapes, and they had chrome effect Winamp. On the buttons Winamp. And stuff. Winamp and Kejofol, yeah. And Fubar 2000. I want those back. I want some 90s style non-rectangular desktop applications to come back again. But I mean, the great thing about technology, yeah. You know, nothing is really dead. If you want something, you can probably find it. I got one of my old, you know, 1990s apps running on Windows 10 the other day just for nostalgia, and it still works. You know, nothing. You get abandonware. There's companies like, do you know GOG.com? Good old games, where they take all the games from like the 80s and the 90s, and you can buy them for like $3 or €3, and you can go, oh, it's X-Wing, just like back in 1996.
Yeah, now it's so, you know, nothing PC in instead of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah, I think the world needs WordPerfect, and personally, I want funky music players without rounded corners and stuff.
Okay, we have another one. So what is the? Yeah. It was edited. So what do you think are main unresolved problems or issues of modern web that are yet to be addressed by the next generation of innovators?
The biggest single problem that I think underpins almost all the negatives and downsides about the web is we never worked out a way of spending small amounts of money easily. You know, I would love to come up with, or I would love to see a solution where, you know, you want to watch a YouTube video, you watch it, but you don't have to watch adverts. It's like, pay us 5 cents, or, you know, 1 ruble, or $1, or whatever. Microtransactions, this has never worked. And because we never got a good model for spending small amounts of money, the whole web ended up being driven by advertising as the main way that websites could make revenue. And the problem with advertising is it gives you a financial incentive to drive people to your website. You're not there to make them happy. You're not there to get a good experience. You're there to get them looking at it. And so you can print fake, you know, made up fictional headlines. You can print scandal, clickbait, racism, all kinds of crap that people will click on because they're like, oh, this is terrible. I have to see what it says. And then suddenly you've got a page impression that translates into advertising revenue. And, you know, I, as somebody who creates content, you know, nothing I've done has been like a bestseller, but I got a couple of 100,000 views on YouTube and I get about a, you know, a couple of 1,000 hits a month on my blog. And if every one of those people could, you know, drop by and say, yeah, we'll give you, I don't know, 20 cents or something. Over time, that builds up into a stable source of revenue for creators that means they can focus on creating interesting content and putting it out there. You know, I think that's the single biggest thing, biggest problem I see with the web right now. And it's not something I see getting solved anytime soon. There's a browser called Brave. I don't know if you know it, but Brave is, it's a browser with a built-in ad blocker that uses something called a basic attention token, a BAT, a BAT. And the idea is that you, in Brave, you watch adverts and the adverts give you credit. And then you browse websites or you look at tweets or you look at YouTube and you click, yeah, I like this. And then it takes some of the money from the advertisers and it transfers those to the people who created the content. And it's a really interesting and innovative model, but it's not anywhere close to getting enough widespread adoption that anyone is going to be able to quit their job and make a living off the money they're making from Brave browsing that's going on. But that, in a nutshell, you know, the web is brilliant for buying big, expensive things. You know, you want to book a flight, you want to book a holiday, you want to buy a guitar or order some hardware or computer equipment or buy Photoshop. It's great. But if you just, you know, you look at a blog post or an article on Medium and you're like, you know, if I met this person in a bar, I'd be like, hey, I really like your article. Let me buy you a drink or let me get you a cup of coffee or something. We haven't got that yet. And I still, there's probably been 10 or 15 different companies have come and gone that have been trying to solve that problem. And none of them have done it yet. And that's the thing that I think would most change and improve the web and the way we all connect online and you know, the way that the digital communication network underpins the way modern society is working. But I don't know if it's solvable, and if it is, I don't know how to solve it. Otherwise, I'd be out there working on it right now.
Thank you for your answer, Dylan, and thank you for your very nice presentation. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, okay, folks, you can continue talking with people who might be interesting in asking more questions in discussion zone, which is available through this link somewhere here in our video player. Thank you very much. But the one thing left, Dylan, what was your favorite question among these which were asked during this discussion? you remember, you have to pick one.
Yep. So I like the question about what's my favorite abandoned technology.
All right.
I think that's an interesting question because I like the one. It's a good question, and I got to talk about some stuff that's interesting to me. But also, it's a question that kind of takes the idea behind the talk and spins that around into something which is good conversation. So yeah, whoever asked that question, best question. Well done.
All right. This person will get a full pass ticket for our next 8 conferences in summer.
Awesome.
Edition. Yeah.
Well, then
thank
I'll
you
see
very
them
much, folks.
Next.
Yeah, see ya.
All right.
See ya.
I'll see you in the discussion zone.
Yeah.